Kabul has a new buzz in the air. A weary people have re-encountered hope. I've never seen the kites fly so high and the streets so full of purpose. There's a new kid in town. The Northern Alliance has come with fresh promises of a new beginning. But they're not loved by everyone. Their previous rule from 1992 to 1996 was anarchic and bloody. History's taught this city to always look over its shoulder. This place is caught between optimism and apprehension, while it revels in simple pleasures we take for granted. Gone with the wind, it's not, but the patrons at the reopened Bakhta cinema aren't picky. A scratchy rerun of an anti-Soviet Mujaheddin flick keeps them on the edge of their seat. Fida Muhammad used to be an usher till the Taliban closed the cinemas and a landmine claimed his leg. Now he greets people in the foyer not to collect their tickets, but their spare change.
People have always gone to the cinema. They liked it very much, because there was no other form of entertainment. The cinema shows them happiness, experience, humanity and goodness.
But the cinema can't keep pace with demand, but the really big business is in the small screen.
Some parts of Kabul are almost unrecognisable. This is Pashtunistan Street, which is where, under the Taliban, you could always pick up a television quietly. Then it was a somewhat eerie, tense place with the religious police always close to hand. Now, TV culture is out in the open. The secrecy and the hypocrisy have gone, and this place is bustling.
From TV antennas to the latest DVD releases, Kabul seems just a step away from cable. This consumer explosion in one of the poorest countries in the world, and less than a fortnight after the fall of one of the world's most restrictive regimes.
I cannot believe it. That's dramatically completed, very fast, very dramatically the life changed. Because I feel very free. I wasn't afraid from anything. The government.
I met Mohammed Farouk Ishakzai 3 months ago, a cocky guy running a risky TV business. Now it's legitimate, and he's even more cocky. Sales have soared from a few sets a month to 30 a week.
A few times I was in jail because of selling a video or TV, these things.
So but now you can sell freely?
Yeah, selling that and freely is feel so comfort.
Kabul's new TV generation is wasting no time. Rajma and Shabir are too young to remember the family TV, which had been hidden away, just like this entire society. Their father, Abdul Rahim Khoram, is a friend who, under the Taliban, I was never allowed to visit at home, a home furnished in another time when Kabul was peaceful and prosperous.
I remember peace. It was very interesting.
This family meal is extraordinary for the simple fact that it's shared with a foreigner. The veil is slowly lifting on this secret society. The Taliban's iron fist banned me from meeting Khoram's wife and daughters, and who themselves could not leave the house without wearing the top-to-toe burqa.
I have problems. I am sick. If I walk under burqa for long, I get a bad headache as I have weak eyesight. And especially I would not like it for this daughter of mine.
But Rona, like all the women of Kabul, remains shrouded. The Taliban may be gone, but the habit they imposed lingers on. Times are too uncertain to be careless. Rona has never worked outside the home. To the Taliban, she's the perfect wife, dutiful and housebound.
When I first heard about the Taliban going, I got upset because they are also our compatriots. But on the other hand, I was happy because there was no education, no entertainment or higher training opportunities for our children.
My wife is very happy because now she is sure that in the future her daughters could become doctors, engineers. My daughters are intelligent. Why should they not be engineers or doctors just because they are girls? I do not say that Taliban are bad or were bad. They were very nice people, but the system was this way.
Assalamu alaikum.
But sections of the system are showing surprising resilience.
How are you?
Fine.
Nice new jacket, new uniform completely.
Hanafi is a transformed man. As a foreign ministry bureaucrat, he'd been an official Taliban translator, a job which really meant stopping me from filming. It was a soul-destroying job for a former Afghan TV cameraman. But Hanafi was a public servant in fear of the regime and desperate for work. Today, he's had a dramatic makeover, swapping the Taliban turban for a suit, even though his office still bears the hallmarks of his previous bosses.
You were a cameraman for Afghan television, and then under the Taliban, your job was to stop us filming. How do you feel about that now?
That was the policy of the government. Nobody today will stop you filming.
So, and a new suit, no turban, it's a more comfortable uniform?
Yes, this is the way it is.
But how Afghanistan will be in the future remains a mystery. Kabul's new rulers are conducting a makeshift facelift, but the cosmetic changes can't mask the enormity of the task or inspire anything more than anxious optimism.
These small changes, cinema, television, music, beard, turban, these things, may make happy a lot of people. But I'm nervous. We do not have a government yet. And when we have the government, we will be watching. I'm hopeful, but I'm not sure yet. I'm not sure yet.